सॉरी गाइस, द कनेक्शन जस्ट ड्रॉप्ड ऑफ. आई विल सेंड अश्विन अ रिक्वेस्ट अगेन. द कनेक्शन जस्ट ड्रॉप्ड ऑफ. आई विल सेंड हिम अ रिक्वेस्ट अगेन. जस्ट अ मोमेंट, लेट मी सी इफ इज देयर. Let me just check if he has joined. Not yet. Hi Ashif, you're there? Yeah, he's there. He's there. Just a minute.
Hey, hi. Really, sir. So, sorry about that. This is my third SIM card. Okay. So, yeah, we were talking about Martin Crowe, 1992.
Yeah, that's my first memory of a spinner opening the bowling. I'm sure there have been other spinners in the past in Test cricket who might have done it, because in second innings, I think it's a common theme that can be followed across many countries in the Asian conditions especially. So, I'm not sure about that, but that is the first, you know, a daring captaincy move that I had seen.
And after that, what I remember a lot is Mahi handing you over the ball to open the bowling and you doing it very successfully.
See, the only difference between Deepak Patel doing it and me doing it is the fact that T20 had, as a baby, had arrived in cricket, you know?
Yeah.
T20 cricket is a totally different kettle of fish. And I don't know Deepak Patel much, but opening the bowling in was an experience. I had internship of bowling and learning from it in the T20 format. It was very difficult and different. I didn't know what to expect out of it. So I got hit, I got hurt, and then learned from the experience.
Wow. Okay, and talking about your debut, I think your limited overs debut happened in 2010, and the test debut happened in 2011. That was in, of course, in Delhi.
In Delhi, yeah.
Yeah.
Delhi is actually one of my favorite grounds to bowl. I've got a very good record at Delhi.
Yeah. And I believe you were pretty excited to do it when IPL started now.
I was very excited. I was keen on even joining the camp a little earlier, because I wanted to understand the conditions a little bit more and, try and get to know every angle possible in that stadium at Ferozshah Kotla. It's a ground where I have great memories. I made my debut. I was man of the match there. Got 9 wickets. And all those are great memories hanging around. But as a venue in T20 cricket, every venue needs a certain understanding from a player, from a bowler. I kind of understood Mohali really well. I understand Chennai really well. I understand Hyderabad really well. So, every venue needs a certain time understanding it. Over the years, I felt that Delhi, the lengths that you need to bowl, the angles you need to set your fields at, all these things are slightly different, which I've been learning. I played quite a few the other trophy games there as well. So, there is a bit of learning, but I wanted to come early this year and try and understand, and dissect it completely in my head about what plans I had.
Right. I hope that would have happened in time, but yeah, can't do anything about it for now.
No, I'm sure. Fingers crossed, things will happen. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. So, the point I was trying to come to is, second year of the decade, you started your cricketing career in terms of test matches, and you finished the decade with 564 wickets, most by any bowler across formats. Whenever that day comes when you hang your boots, will you look back at that decade and say, I'm really proud of what I achieved in that decade?
I honestly don't know, Sumit, because I sometimes feel this is a complaint that my wife actually complains about it. To an extent, my parents complain about it sometimes, not so much my mom, but my dad does. A lot of occasions, my friends complain about it, that I just cannot hang around one particular moment and work one particular achievement in life and celebrate it enough. I seem to just move on so quickly. I don't know if it's right or wrong, but I'm sure there will be a time. And if it's probably closing in on time that I have to live, maybe that's the day I will say, okay, I've lived a very, a fruitful life. But until then, I just seem to move on. I seem to search for what next. The search in my head is so wide that sometimes I lose sleep over it. And it's not right, but I'm trying to make a balance.
Okay. And And you know that reminds me of what I wanted to ask you when you talk about being quick, moving on from one to another, always being in so much hurry. What's the hurry to get to 50, 100, 150, 200 fastest wickets for? and then
maybe that's the hurry I'm talking about.
And then 350 wickets, fastest to 300 and 350 with Murali Dharan, I believe. So again, always trying to rush in and take quick wickets and make more milestones.
I'd like to give a lot of credit to the Indian media for all those things, because imagine a cricketer starting his journey trying to say I'll be fastest to 50, 100, 150. No, it's not happening. So whenever I'm doing something nice, whenever I get 10 wickets or 5 wickets, or when I get a few wickets in a game, they are immediately putting it on par with a certain number of people and then saying, hey, you know what? Here is a goal. Why don't you achieve it? That's how it seems like to me. So basically, the media has broken down my career into so many halves and so many small targets and motivated me every single game. So that is the only reason I can attribute it to, because I don't remember it. I'm not looking forward to doing it. I'm looking every game that I walk out there, I want to go back happy. I want to go back happy to my room, call my friends, call my parents and say, how did it go? Did you enjoy it? Like, just have a good time, That's why I go out there. I want to be excellent every single day that I play the game. But it's extremely unfortunate that all these things have happened on the way.
Absolutely. And I don't know if I would be putting this right. What does happiness mean for you? Is it picking enough wickets? Is it giving your 100%? What does bring you satisfaction?
On the cricket field, trying to be one better than the other person. I think it's more than picking up wickets or whatever it is. I think it's more about getting into battles. I really, really get into battles. I think one of the reasons why I think I have been able to achieve a certain amount of success in my career is because every time I've been put to the sword, I wanted to get the better of the man the next time. There have been so many cases like that. Kyron Pollard, Glenn Maxwell, I can name quite a few. Yeah, Chris Gayle, all these people. I mean, when I see them, Mahendra Singh Dhoni, when I played for Kings 11 against CSK, I wanted to make sure that Mahi will not be able to, hit me. I need to get his wicket, sort of a thing. I want that stage to be able to compete with big guys. The so-called big people, compete with a Virat, compete with a Rohit, whenever I go up against them. That's more about it. It's the competition that I live for and the pressure that the game throws at me. Rather than, looking at it saying, hey, I need to go and get 4 wickets. I need to clean up the tail, be the man of the match, be the player of the series. No, that doesn't excite me.
Right. Okay. Someone is asking, Dave Mangulkar is asking, what is the maximum number of hours you have practiced bowling inside the nets?
I think most of the mad practices that I've done are pretty much a backlog in my career. I remember one occasion where I bowled about 50, 55 overs in a Duleep Trophy game, Duleep Trophy final, and didn't feel happy about it, and then went again, bowled 20 overs in the same day in the nets after about 3 o'clock in the evening. And I don't think, I would not recommend that to anyone in all honesty, but it's more from a satisfaction point of view from my side of saying, hey, you know what, it's coming out the way I visualize it to come out. So I practice more on feel. It's very difficult for me to say this is the amount of practice that will get you to the best. But for me, I have a feel inside that I know of. And then I have a visual cue for that. I try and attach it. Maybe sometimes it can go over the head of people when I talk like this. But I practice only for that. If it happens in the first 10 balls, I'm done. I'll finish it off.
Okay. You want to take the next one from Karthik. In which programming language can you write code?
None.
Okay.
None, literally none.
And Jay wants to know, who is your favorite off spinner?
I am pretty much my favorite off spinner. I don't think I need to look anywhere else for inspiration right now.
Awesome. Okay. I'll read out a quote, Ash, and I want to know your reaction. Okay. So the quote is, in 1991, I had predicted that Sanjay and Ravi would make very good commentators. I am now saying that about Ashwin by the great Harsha Bhogle. So, any thoughts of getting into commentary post-cricket?
See, one thing I've learned being in the cricketing fraternity and being around this community is not to make commitments towards anything. I the reason why I live very much in the present and I want to focus on it. And I'm doing this because of two things. I want to give a positive spin to how people are perceiving life. And I also want to, you know, be occupied. Like I said, mine is a very active mind. And for me, if I don't give enough work to my mind, it's very difficult for me. So that's exactly why I'm doing it. But if people are really happy with what I'm doing it and they're enjoying it, that's where the buck stops. And I'm very honored that Harsha came out and said that and so on and so forth. But I've always had, I have so many questions that I want to ask people who painted this game. That have painted this game over the years. You know, the broadcasters, the people who bring it to you, the people who coach and all the... I have so many questions for them that I have anyway. So I'm just putting it out there and just making it interesting for myself and everyone.
And I think Reminisce with Ash also would be helping you because you're getting so many people who have played the game, you know. So that's interesting.
So many people who have played the game and somebody like a Sanjay Manjrekar who went on... thank you. So that particular episode is something that I was looking forward to. Because, you know, a lot of people tend to roast people for putting, you know, painting a picture. And I feel everybody has a story, you know. Everybody wants to make a career. In the case of Sanjay especially, he's looking at it as a career. He wants to be the best at what he does. So I wanted to understand why. And so I wanted to go live with him. And it's not, I'm not known for controversy. I'm known for usually asking inquisitive questions and learning from it. And actually in all these, you know, chats that I've been having on Instagram and with all these people, I'm learning a lot. So that's what I'm looking forward to.
Wow. Nice. Okay. Ash, I think we are running short of time. You'll also have to go pretty soon. And there's so much I had lined up, you know, but I already see we have gone close to 45, 46 minutes with you. So how much time roughly you would have, like 15, 20 minutes max?
Yeah. Depends on what you want to ask, how entertained you want to keep me.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, so you have been doing this really well, Reminisce with Ash. Okay, today let's turn the tables and make you the guest.
Okay,
and talk about your career, some of your performances, and answers can be quick, long, up to you. And I'll get started. Okay, so the first question, it's not a question actually, the first performance we are talking about is 2011 IPL final. You picked up 3 for 16. And all important wicket of Chris Gayle in the first over of the chase. You want to talk about that performance?
So this IPL, actually, Chris had turned the tide around so much for RCB, right? And he came in. He came in after the seventh game for RCB and just, you know, just took off like a rocket. And he put RCB. I remember, I think CSK played RCB at Bangalore and we were like basically pummeled. 126 or something we got and they chased it back. But I put Chris under a lot of pressure in that game as well. I beat him a few times. It was one of those times, from about 2009 to like, I could say all through till today. There have been, you know, times where I haven't been able to get wickets at will. But most often than not, 80% of my career is the wickets have come. You know, the wickets have come, the performances have come, or whatever it is. So that particular time, it was not even 80. It was 110 out of 100 that was working. So whatever I was doing till about 2012, 13, 14, especially in that IPL scenario, it just used to come together so beautifully. Whatever I did worked. And that also made sure I learned. So in that final, what happened was previously when we played RCB at the qualifier, I got Chris out again. He was out LBW. I think it might have been umpires called to Simon Toffel now, I reckon. But he hit me for a six in that game and then got out. So it was basically like everybody was tipping this off. Ospinner versus Chris. That's the best matchup. And Ashwin is really, really bowling well and good rhythm and all that. This whole build-up of the contest. And I can't start and tell you how it is that in that particular final, I had planned how I should bowl to Chris, you know, ball by ball, and how I should dismiss him. And the only difference in the dismissal that I visualized in the way he got out was I wanted to get him bowled off stump and he nicked off. Because I remember a similar ball to Jesse Ryder in the same IPL where Jesse stepped out and hit me for a six. And the common mistake a lot of batsmen do is they try and think, you know, a lot of bowlers don't think and they react to deliveries, but I don't do that. If you hit me for a six, I will try and stay as unpredictable, as attacking as possible. And I knocked over Jesse Ryder with an arm ball the very next ball. So, likewise, I imagined something for Chris and it worked. And I couldn't believe myself and I took off. One of the finest, you know, three ball sets that I bowled in my career.
Wow. So that's a great insight to hear, you know, bowling in sets. Okay. Next thing is, I'll show you a picture and it will bring about a lot of memories.
Nice.
Yeah. So quarter final 2 for 52 against Australia. You took Watson's wicket and went on to win the World Cup. So how was that feeling?
See, I personally rate Shane Watson very highly. I mean, he's got the better of me on a few occasions, but I mean, one or two occasions or maybe more. But I've got him out a lot of times as well in the IPL against Australia, in test matches, in ODIs and so on and so forth. Because I really rate him as a, you know, a batsman. He's unbelievable batter. So in this game, again, this was a completely different occasion for me. Usually, I don't get pressurized of an occasion or for a game or seeing an opponent. But this was one of those occasions where the whole, the magnitude of the game just fell upon me. Like, it was, I felt like the entire country was sitting on my head and saying, hey, you know what? Come on, deliver. There is so much hype yeah. around what you can do and come on, deliver, sort of a feeling I had. And the moment Mahi gave me the new ball, I didn't know what to do really. And for the first 2-3 hours, my hand was trembling. Yeah. So, Mahi came up to me and said, you know, just relax a little bit. I think you're landing, you're bowling well, but you're just in a little bit of hurry. Just relax a little bit. And he switched ends for me. And when I came back again, it was, you know, my undercutter that delivered. Because Shane Watson was looking, because the wicket was aiding a little bit of spin too. There was a bit of grip. And I think Shane Watson was looking for me to, you know, get the bounce and try and slog with me. Because of my bounce, a lot of batsmen tend to take me square of the wicket. And I slid underneath because of my undercutter. And it was a very memorable ball that I bowled.
Wow. And who was your second wicket?
And second wicket was Ricky Ponting. So, you know, like I said, big names, but Ricky had made a lovely 100. Yeah. So, I would like to say I got him out and it was the proceedings of the game.
Right. Okay. Next photo is going to be up now. And yeah, a debut test match.
This was the debut test match or was it? It was in Mumbai, debut. I think, right?
Yeah, this was from that series.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
your debut match, 9 wickets, then you scored a century, 5 for, I believe. So 22 wickets in 3 test matches. So maybe you just talk about that series because it was your first one.
I didn't know what had hit me. Seriously, I basically felt like I was hitting a truck or a truck was hitting me, because you know I had this dream run. Then the IPL stardom, then the sort of whatever I touched was turning to gold. And then I went on to the Champions League in 2010, won the Man of the Series, the Golden Ball. Came back, highest wicket taker for Chennai Super Kings in that IPL in 2011. We won the IPL. And then in 2011, I was doing very well in one day cricket. I kind of became the main spinner for the team. And then yeah. I get my test call up. I end up with a 9-4 in the first test. Then I get married. Then I go back and play the next test. We win it. And then the next test, I go and make a 100, get a 5-4 and a 4-4. So I felt like, you know, this must be really an easy game. I think people just make out too much of it. So that sort of, you know, wow, that's a tremendous start. If I'm sitting here and watching yeah. someone do it today, I would feel like, wow, this kid has arrived.
Wow. Okay. That brings me to the next image. We've talked enough about your bowling. Can you remember?
Okay, this is the partnership I had with Rohit.
Yeah, right? Yeah. 280-run partnership. 2013. Yeah, Rohit. Yeah,
this was Rohit's first 100.
I can't remember exactly. But the 280-run partnership.
Yeah, I actually, just before the series, this must have been in 2013 against West Indies in Calcutta. Yeah. So, about six to eight months or probably 10 months before, we had this really, this was probably 2013. Yeah, correct. So,
yeah,
we had this, so, we had this England series we lost in 2012 and then we played 2013 against Australia. We won that series and this must have been after that, if I'm not wrong. So, I had about 10, 12 months ago, I had hired a trainer. I didn't understand how exactly trainers worked. And a lot of people I felt had this knack of, you know, overloading someone, not understanding someone's body. I have this like really long lower body and a, you know, comparatively shorter upper body and all that. I needed people to understand my body, and I think I found the right trainer then. I had been like really working hard for the 10-12 months then leading up to this test series from Australia to this time, and I could feel the difference in my batting and in my skill work right then. So when you talk about this series, it was all about the resolve I dug up in, and bowling and batting, and to be able to manage the energy reserves was directly attributed to the kind of training I started doing then.
Wow. So, never knew about that. Okay. Yes.
Okay, so, this is Sri Lanka, right? This is Sri Lanka at
2015.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, at so the Pisara Stadium.
Yeah, Sangakkara retired after the second test of the three-match series. And right. In that two matches, you got him four times.
Yeah, and what sticks out here for me is that KL Rahul is keeping wickets, because Saha pulled his hamstring through that test match and he didn't keep wickets. And okay. In Sri Lanka that year, especially, I can remember, the ball was coming out like magic, literally magic. Whatever, wherever I wanted the ball to land, how much ever I wanted it to drift, and whatever I was telling, the ball was actually doing that. So I was like, oh my God, what's happening here? Is it a phase, or is it understanding my own skills? And I think I have been a completely different bowler once I moved on from South Africa in 2014. I went to South Africa, didn't get a wicket in one test match and got left out. Mm-hmm. Came back, played the T20 World Cup, and then embarked on this lovely Australian tour in 2015. And ever since, I've been a completely different bowler. I've learned so many more dimensions in bowling and so many more tricks and better awareness and understanding of me as a bowler. And that's probably what people call as experience, or people call as coming of age or maturity. But this is a series that will stick in my head forever.
Okay, if this will stick in your head forever, I'm pretty sure the next one is also going to stick in your head for a long time. Let me
I'm gonna
try
guess.
And...
okay. I'm going to guess.
Okay.
Hashim Amla.
Let's see. Yeah. Won't be.
No, right.
You're not very off, because we're talking about the South Africa series. Yeah. Four test matches in 2015, 31 wickets. And your highest tally in a series. Best performance, 12 wickets in the third test in Nagpur. So... yeah, what was happening
so
here?
Like I told you, this 2015, right? It was 2015, 2016, and those phases ever since that Australian tour in 2014-15. I have been a completely different bowler and a completely different person on the field. Because when I grew up as a cricketer playing first class cricket for Tamil Nadu, I had this coach who's the Indian women's team coach, W.V. Raman. He used to say one thing to me all the time. The most important thing for a bowler is to be able to hit the right lengths all the time and to be able to hit the top of the bat when the batsman defends. So that always stuck with me, and it's not an easy thing to do. Every time a batsman defends, if you want to hit the top of his blade, it means you're doing a lot of things right. You're hitting the right length, you're getting your flight right, and you're getting the drop on the ball, you know, a drop on the batsman. So all these things need to go right. And ever, like I told you, ever since that 2014 phase, bounce has always been my strength in my life. But I got this whole thing of drift, usage of wrist, awareness of my bowling, and, you know, getting the length and strategies right. Planning and strategies are one thing, but to be able to deliver according to that plan and the strategy is a completely another thing, for which you need complete mastery of your skill. And that started happening after that 2014-15 Australia series. And this is like 100, you know, whatever you works. So as a cricketer, I've gone through that phases a lot in my career. Another phase where if I delivered.
Wow. Amazing. I think we have got almost all the matches we wanted to talk about. If we go on, it will never end. So I'll quickly switch to the next segment. But there are a few facts really nice, you know. This Saha Chaudhary, a great fan of you, Ash. I have more than 150 paper cuttings of you. That's nice.
Was there a question? Did I miss it?
No. Saha Chaudhary is saying he has more than 150 paper cuttings of you.
Oh, wow. Right. That's sweet. Thank you, Saha. Thank you.
There's another question coming from one of the fans, Krunal. He's saying, can you please talk about the ball of the century.
I've talked so much about that ball of the century, so to say. No, it was a very special delivery, and I had what gives me pleasure out of it is the strategy and the idea to go around, and it was a very instinctive plan that I made as the T20 World Cup started. And the ability to be able to deliver is one, but I stuck with it despite, you know, people challenging it sometimes. They kept asking me if it was too negative to start off. A lot of people come to me with this idea. And, you know, try to get wickets. But going around the stumps, who said wasn't attacking enough? So, this I felt was the right plan at that point of time, and it worked. And I take a lot of credit for that.
Amazing. Okay, so the next segment we have put up for you is called In. I'm pretty sure you're going to enjoy it. Emma, you get my voice there?
Sumit, you're breaking up again.
Hello?
Are you okay now?
Yes, I guess so. I don't know what's the problem now.
You're fine. Is it?
Yeah. Okay, so as long as I'm fine, I was talking about the next segment called In a Parallel Universe, and I'm pretty sure you're gonna. So you know how it goes. Just a minute.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna to talk about in a parallel universe. What would that be? Okay. Did you get me there? Hi. Hello. Did you get me? Oh man. What do I do?
Yeah. Much better.
Okay, so in a parallel universe is our next segment. I'm going to give you a situation and see what's your reaction to it. Okay, so we'll do the first one and let's see how it goes. So the first one is in a parallel universe, Ashwin will play the role of Dash in Game of Thrones.
Tyrion Lannister.
Oh my God. Okay, that's... one of my favorite characters, no doubt about it.
I love the character. I love the intellect of Tyrion Lannister. And I love the way he, you know, even he's able to bring out humor despite all the odds against him. Even in situations where he's pushed to a corner, he sees the funny side of things, which I love about Tyrion.
And the best is his explanation. I just drink and I know.
Correct. Have you watched this serial called Blacklist that's going on Netflix now?
No, not yet. How is it?
Yeah, the character Raymond Reddington is also... very similar. I love it.
Wow. Okay. I'll put it on my list. I'm pretty late on Breaking Bad. That's what I'm finishing right now.
Oh, wow. Nice.
Yeah. Okay. So, second one. In a parallel universe, Ashwin's favorite shot as an opening batsman is Dash.
Cover drive.
Okay. That's nice. Okay. Third one is interesting. In a parallel universe, Ashwin would have met Preeti in Dash.
In Dash? Okay.
Yeah. Not in school, obviously.
In a train?
In a train. Okay, that's interesting.
Watching all those 90s romantic movies, I think in a train has always been some sort of a fascination. So, why not give it a shot?
That's nice. Okay. The next one is, Ashwin hates cricket and is a successful player in the sport of Dash.
Tennis or basketball?
Okay. You played tennis a lot? Or
yeah, I actually started playing tennis first before I moved on to cricket. I love tennis because my granddad, he encouraged me playing tennis all through my young age. I started when I was 6. I'm okay with tennis. I'm not bad. Even now, I have a decent forehand and all that. But I used to play ball badminton for Tamil Nadu when I was younger.
Okay.
And basketball, I played it at college level. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Next one is related to cooking, obviously, which you don't like. So, the question is, Ashwin has tuned his culinary skills and loves making Dash.
Lemon juice.
So, special lemon juice by Chef Ashwin.
Lemon juice is okay. Coffee, green tea, all this is great options. I can provide the entire range for you.
Okay. Next one. Ashwin doesn't remember any Kamal Hassan movie except Dash.
Oh my God. Okay. Except Panchatantra.
Okay.
Panchatantra is a comedy flick of Kamal Haasan.
Okay. I'm sure it's epic.
It's unbelievable. If you can get translation, you should try it.
Absolutely.
I think it's there on Amazon, if I'm not wrong.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll check. Okay, so the last question in this is, Ashwin's bowling action has been erased and has been replaced by the action of dash.
Nice. Replaced by the action of Anil Kumble.
Beautiful. The first visual which comes to my mind is the bandage, you know, him bowling with that bandage.
Yeah, and he got Brian Lara out. That's no mean achievement.
The moment you speak about his name, I mean, so many memories. Wow. Okay, so that brings end to this segment, and we go to the last segment. The last segment is something we had done with Dada and Ricky and Kef also. It's just putting yourself against you. So it's okay. Going to be Ash versus Ash. And I'm pretty sure, I'm convinced you're going to excel at this because that's your forte.
So what do I do?
So I'll ask you a question about your career and you just need to answer. Okay.
Oh my God. Okay. Right. Now it's pressure. Okay.
Okay. So I'll start with the first question. Against which team did you pick your 300 test wicket and who was the victim?
300 test wicket was against Sri Lanka, Lahiru Gamage. Okay, right. Good.
Yeah. That's a good start. The second question is, how many times have you scored a century and taken a fifer in the same test?
A fifer?
Yeah.
Yeah, twice, I think. Twice.
Again, you're right. I knew you were going to nail it.
Okay. And I was actually going to say 3, then I turned to 2.
Okay, that was good. The third question is, you were part of 100 plus partnership in ODIs. Who was your partner and who was the opposition?
New Zealand, Ravindra Jadeja.
You sure?
Oh my God, I got it wrong, did I? Oh, okay. Only 100 in partnership. Is that what you said?
Yeah, in ODI.
In ODI. I've been only in 100 partnership in an ODI. I think 2, yeah. No? Okay, fine. I'll change it. Mahendra Singh Dhoni against Pakistan.
Absolutely. And at your favorite ground, probably?
At Chepauk, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so how was that? I mean, if you could just...
No, we made 50s, both me and Jadu in a game in New Zealand.
Okay,
and
the so game I'll check tied. That.
Sorry?
Okay. I'll check that. Maybe I'm wrong. I'll check.
No, possibly it's not a 100-run partnership then. I'm not sure.
Okay. So the fourth question is, what are your best test figures and against whom?
Best test figures? You mean in an innings or a match?
In an innings, I believe.
In an innings, I think it is 7-4. It's a 7-4. I'm wondering which team it is against. It could have been South Africa, Australia. Australia 7-405. Who else have I got a 7-4 against? 7-4. Oh my God, I'm really struggling here.
You want a hint?
7-4 against England. I don't think I got a 7-4 against England. 7-4 against South Africa. 13-4 I got. Correct. Against New Zealand.
Yeah, you're right. 7-4-59.
Correct.
Yeah, in indoor.
In indoor, yeah. That was the first test in indoor.
Next question probably would be easy for you. Your first ODI victim.
Upul Tarang.
Yeah, right.
That's quite easy.
Yeah. We tried to keep a couple of tough questions also. So we'll test you there. Okay. The next one is, against which team have you scored the most runs in tests?
Against which team have I scored the most runs?
Yeah.
Has to be West Indies, I think.
No, surprisingly not.
Okay, hold. Will I get another shot at it?
Yeah, absolutely. Go for it.
I think it is England.
Yeah. So you have scored 4 centuries against West Indies, but you have scored most runs against England.
My record
England.
Against England is a lot better than against West Indies. I make a lot of runs against them.
Yeah, 781.
Okay.
Any special reason you love them so much?
No, I think we played similar attacks. Broad and Anderson have been around whenever we played England. That could be one of the reasons. And I don't know. We also played a lot of test matches against England. One team against which I thought my record would get better was Australia. I'm a little disappointed, but there's time to make up.
Great. And just one insight. The partnership with Jaddu was 85 runs.
Okay, right. At Auckland. Yeah. Nice.
Yeah. Okay, moving on. How many Man of the Series trophies have you won in tests?
7.
Most by an Indian?
Yeah. I think so.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Number 8. You were the highest test match wicket taker in 2016. How many wickets did you take?
Oh my God. This is hard. Can you give me 4 choices?
Yeah. 72, 73, 74, 75.
we're talking 2016, right?
Yes.
Okay. 2016. We played 4 tests in West Indies. That's about 17 wickets. Then we played 28 against England. Sorry, 28 against New Zealand, which is 28 and a 17. That's 45. And then about 28 against England again. So that's 45, 55, 63. 73.
Pretty close, but I think we can give it to you, man. 73 is not a bad guess. The answer is 72.
72, okay, right.
Yeah, we can give it to you. And last 2 questions now. Question number 9 is, which batsman have you dismissed the most number of times in IPL?
In IPL? Robin Nutap. Oh, okay. Depends on what you're talking about. Maximum number of times. Robin, Chris. I think it is Robin Uthappa, right?
What you're thinking is absolutely right.
Okay.
Bang on. Right. Yeah. And the last question is, name the city in which you made your debut for India in each format.
Oop. That's hard. Okay. Test cricket, Delhi.
Yeah.
Okay. One day cricket, Harare, Zimbabwe.
Yeah. No. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, you're right. Okay. You're right.
T20 again. Okay. Must have been Harare, Zimbabwe 2010. Yeah, Harare, Zimbabwe again.
Yeah, right.
Oh, yeah. So, you thought it's Harare, Sri Lanka against Sri Lanka and Zimbabwe. Harare, Zimbabwe versus Zimbabwe in T20s.
Yeah, perfect.
I meant Harare, Zimbabwe as a country.
Yeah. So, you have got, I think, almost 9 or 10 right.
Okay, there are 10 questions. 73, you were kind to give it to me. But I don't know why I missed it. I think my calculation was wrong, I think. 17 and 28 is 45. 45 and 28 is 73. And how much did I say?
73, 45. You said.
And you said 72, right?
2, yeah.
So, I think I must have got 16 in West Indies and I mistook it to be 70.
Okay.
Or won against somebody.
Yeah, but still, a great job. And I think I'm nearly done with my questions. I just want to take a few fan questions and wind up this chat. And so the problem with Instagram handles is, you can't get people's name all the time. You have to read, like, now the next one is pg.inc. He's asking, I would have loved to take his name. He's asking, with which batsman was your biggest battle that you won, Ash?
Biggest battle. So I think Glenn Maxwell is a battle that I enjoyed, and he gave me something to think about. He, in fact, put me to the sword a few occasions, and then I started understanding how to get him out, and I repeatedly got him out later on and found success with it. So that's a contest I always enjoy.
Wow. The next one is, Ash, please tell us something about Delhi Capitals. Wow, nice. We didn't speak much about it.
Yeah, for me, I think I was really, really looking forward to this Delhi Capitals stint this year. Simply because I was excited with the kind of players I would be playing alongside. Ajinkya was going to be there. Ishant was going to be there. We have a great camaraderie amongst us. We played for India for a long time now. Shikhar is there. It's an unbelievable combination. Make it 4. And then you've got exciting talent like, Rishabh is around. Shreyas has got off to a great start to his international career. So that's 6 proper Indians. Adding to which Hetmyer, Rabada, it was a great bunch and I was really looking forward to being there. Especially after what we've seen the Kotla wicket do over the last couple of seasons. So, it's quite disappointing, but you never know. Hopefully, COVID-19 can be kind and the scientists can be even more innovative and put a vaccine on the street as soon as possible.
Absolutely. Okay, sorry, I started laughing way before because the next question is very interesting. BSK_Phoenix_wins. Okay, that's the handle. The question is, when are you going to bowl left arm in international cricket?
See, I wasn't very far from bowling left arm spin in IPL in 2013. I was actually doing a really good job of bowling left arm orthodox. And I used to bowl Chinaman as well in a couple of local club games. I was serious about it, but then didn't get a lot of backing. And then my left shoulder snapped one day when I was bowling. So I just gave it a break. I don't think it's possible now. But if somebody wants to watch me bowl left arm spin, they can come and have a hit in a club net or something.
Okay. Let me find more questions. Because how is your lockdown going? Yeah, he has answered that. What makes you happy? A fifer or a century by Gaurav?
A fifer and a century, but I will take fifer.
Okay. Ash, one very serious question. I just wanted to get your opinion on it. You know, people don't talk a lot about it in our country. It's about mental health. And lately, you know, whether it's about Glenn Maxwell talking about it or Sarah Taylor talking about it, you know, in a modern day cricket where getting a time off the sport is like a luxury, how important is it to have teams with dedicated staff who can focus on their mental health?
See, I think what happens a lot in team environments, especially in cricket, I can't vouch for other sport, but it's always existed in other sports. But for me, in cricket, there is this whole taboo of people voicing their opinions. People who are voicing their opinions and are being, you know, and you can count on them to give you honest feedbacks all the time. You can count on them to be really honest about their well-being and the team's well-being. So they would not have problems a lot of times. But there is this whole taboo of people speaking about it. The moment you say, you know what, I'm not feeling all right mentally, people start questioning your ticker. You know, they say he's not courageous enough. You know, this is just an old way, old fashion of looking at it. They say he's very soft and sort of a thing. But you don't understand what a cricketer goes through in his career, right? Because he's constantly jailed in a hotel room. He's constantly playing the game. He's constantly traveling. He doesn't take a break. Over. If you're having a long career on the road, international cricket, IPL and all this sort of stuff, over 10, 12, 15 years, you have missed a major chunk of your an adulthood, right? In some cases, teenhood. And you miss out on a lot of friends. You lose relationships on the way because you're putting everything on the line to be the person that you are. Be the cricketer that you are. So people don't understand, and on the way they start losing their whole character. They're not themselves. So to be able to trust someone and go to them in a team environment is so critical. What happens is very often people of the same age groups don't get it. And because it's such a competitive space being in a team environment, people are vying for one another's spot. It's not very healthy to be able to rely on someone and talk about weaknesses. So to have someone inside the team who you can trust 100%, that he will look after your well-being, I think it's very, very critical. We are about there to a stage where you had people inside the team, not necessarily only people with expertise or education, but people even who can just take it and be a sounding board inside the team is very critical.
Great. That's great. And that brings me to a lighter question by Vinay Sharma. He's asking you, Ash, will Corona end? Please reply.
I'm hoping the lockdown ends and then we can look at whether Corona ends, because it's crazy. It's crazy because you are on the streets and people are still understanding this virus from start to, you know, end. And we are still not sure what sort of treatments are being given, how much hardships people are going through, what sort of facilities we have in a country like India. You know, there are a billion people, and to be able to cater to every individual is going to be so, so hard. But despite that, I think as a country, we are putting up a very brave fight against this virus. When I went on the road on the other yesterday, I saw that people are so disciplined. They are making an effort. It's not that easy. But vendors that are outside selling essential stuff are also trying to make, you know, take precautions. The people are doing their best. The government is doing their best. The world, you know, clinical research industry is doing their best. So I think I'll be safe in saying that humanity will get past this. We are a very resilient race. We will get past this as well. But on the way, there are going to be people that there are going to be very, very important lives that we will lose, important times that we will have to get past. But all in all, I think it will end one day, but we have to be preparing and sharpening our knife edges so that one day it ends and we are all able to bounce back to our best abilities.
Absolutely. And brings me to last couple of questions from our fans. I saw one question, Ash. I think it's very interesting. Shrikant Padmanabhan, he's asking your opinion on adapting to different management and dressing rooms in IPL, because you have been part of quite successful teams. So how difficult it is to adapt to different managements and teams?
See, I think for a franchisee-based sport, which IPL is now, and there are other franchisee-based sports around the world as well, I think it's more about creating a DNA for a franchisee, you know. Every player walking into the franchisee needs direction of knowing how top-down the direction is, what is the DNA of this franchisee, what sort of cricket do they play, how top-down are they, how much are they like a family, how much explosive cricket do they play. You know, how do they, where do they get back? Are they very impulsive sort of a franchisee? Are they very responsive? Are they very planned? Are they very process oriented? So I think it's very important for a franchisee to nail down the DNA first. A lot of teams, they've managed to put together good cricketers, but have failed to not understand and set up a DNA for the side. But most of the franchisees that have built a DNA and relied on it and relied on that process of setting the DNA have eventually come out and shown great results. So I think it's about that. The management is a smaller representation of what the franchisee stands for. It's basically top down. Any company in the corporate world, if you see, it's driven by the owners, the promoters, the directors. They run it down, then it goes down to the COO, then it goes down to the CEO, COO, and then the managerial staff. So it's very similar. A support staff or coaching staff are like your CEOs and COOs. They are operational, but it comes top down. How the DNA or the promoters want to push the team forward is extremely critical.
Right. And I'll show you a video. That's why I'm just taking off my headphones. And when I show you the video, chances are the internet might act up. So I kept it for the last. Okay.
Okay. Right. Nice. I've enjoyed this. Even I put this on Instagram.
Yeah. So that was our excitement when we got to you. And just want to discuss this one in Hindi. So a lot of our Delhi fans would enjoy the chat.
They will enjoy the entertainment that comes with my Hindi also.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. I heard you in press conferences and different places, you spoke about continuously getting better with your Hindi. So I think you're doing great.
Right.
अच्छा तो आश मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है आपसे कि दिल्ली कैपिटल्स में जैसे ही डिसीजन हुआ कि आप दिल्ली कैपिटल्स आ रहे हो तो एक्साइटमेंट से ज्यादा ओवरऑल क्या थॉट प्रोसेस और क्या गोल्स लेके आ रहे हो आप दिल्ली कैपिटल्स में?
नहीं, सबसे पहले मेरा ऐसा फील था कि एक फ्रेंचाइजी से मैं बाहर आ रहा था और दिल्ली जैसा फ्रेंचाइजी जिसने क्वालिफाई हुआ उस साल और उनके जो प्लेयर्स थे दिल्ली कैपिटल्स में वो सब एक्साइटिंग थे. या ऋषभ पंत था या पृथ्वी शॉ, उसका नाम भी भूल गया मैंने जब पहले बात किया हम, पृथ्वी शॉ का नाम भूल गया. और मेरा फीलिंग ये था कि जैसे मेरा एक्सपीरियंस है और जितना मैं प्रेशर में बॉलिंग करता हूँ और आके दिल्ली में वो एक्सपीरियंस अगर इस्तेमाल सही तरीके से होगा फिर ये टीम के साथ जोड़कर अच्छा मेमोरीज बना सकता हूँ. वैसे ही थॉट प्रोसेस था मेरा और मैं कंप्लीटली लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड था ये सीजन के लिए कि कैसा रहेगा ये टीम मैनेजमेंट. मैं सबसे ज्यादा लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड था रिकी पॉन्टिंग के साथ काम करने के लिए, क्योंकि मैं बहुत सारी चीज सुना था रोहित से जैसे वो मुंबई इंडियंस में काम किया. और लास्ट ईयर भी हम किंग्स और दिल्ली का गेम, दिल्ली कैपिटल्स ऐसा लगा कि वो क्वालिफाई नहीं होंगे, पीछे था और बॉटम से शायद सिक्स या सेवन्थ प्लेस में था और उधर से एक मोमेंटम बना के लेके आया टीम को ऊपर और दे फिनिश्ड इन द पहले, आई थिंक दे फिनिश्ड इन द फर्स्ट टू एंड द टीम वाज ऑन अ रोल. सो मुझे लगा ये टीम को जैसे बॉलिंग अगर स्ट्रेंथन होगा, मिशी बाय भी था और अक्षर पटेल भी था, अगर स्ट्रेंथन होगा स्पिन के जैसे होम कंडीशंस में अच्छा इस्तेमाल करके हम जीत सकते हैं तो ये टीम प्रॉपर फ्रंट रनर हो सकता है. सो वैसे फीलिंग से आया मैं टीम इस टीम से खेलने के लिए और अभी थोड़ा ऐसा फीलिंग है कि ये हो नहीं पाया इस साल, बट यू नेवर नो. आई जस्ट होप एंड फिंगर्स क्रॉस्ड आईपीएल होगा.
Absolutely, Ashu. And we all looking forward to the IPL. And we would want to end with a note ki aap ek fans ko aapke end se message de do, because you all are very influential people, and fans to stay patient and stay at home, and anything you want to tell them about the current situation.
See, सबसे पहले चीज ये है कि ये COVID-19 जो वायरस है उसके बारे में हम ज्यादा सीखना चाहिए. अभी जो हमको पता है वो जो जितना भी लोग मीडिया में बोल रहे होता है, सो इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी अंडरस्टैंड मोर अबाउट इट. जितना भी हम प्रिकॉशंस लेके घर में रह सकते हैं, और घर से हम अगर घर में रहेंगे सो बाहर जो लोग जाते हैं कि हर रोज वो लोग लौट सकते हैं, और उसके बाद हम जब भी बाहर जाएंगे सारे प्रिकॉशंस लेकर जाएंगे, जब मास्क पहनना, ये सब थोड़ा थोड़ा प्रिकॉशंस लेकर, सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग जरूरी रहेगा, ये सब लोग बोल रहे हैं, बट जब तक वैक्सीन नहीं आएगा और जब तक हमारा मेडिसिन पूरे तरह से ये वायरस को अंडरस्टैंड नहीं कर सकते, उस टाइम तक हम थोड़ा ध्यान से रहना पड़ेगा, और घर में रहिए और सेफ रहिए.
Thank you so much. I hope apart from the internet, I didn't trouble you much.
That's fine. It was all good, Sumit. Enjoyed it so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time. Thank you everyone for joining, and we'll see you soon.
Good night. Good night. Yeah.
Good night.